I now bring you the discussion of the day. The Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, NIRPP, put out a discussion paper dealing with compulsory licenses for the pharmaceutical sector. Opinions have come in, and now we understand that this could be in its final stages and could be just waiting cabinet approval. To join us now to discuss the implications of what the government is hoping to do as far as the issue of compulsory licenses is concerned, and to also link this issue to the issue of foreign direct investment, which could impact mergers and acquisitions into the sector, DG Shah, Secretary General of the Indian Pharmaceutical Alliance. Mr. Shah, many thanks for joining us on CNBC TV 18. We've been trying to get the OPPI to join in on this discussion. We haven't had much luck. So let me play devil's advocate and bring to you the points that OPPI has put forward on this discussion paper, which go against what the government or what the Indian Pharmaceutical Alliance has to say. Let me start by addressing the first issue which the OPPI says. It says even a prima facie analysis of the situation in India would make it apparent that patents are not the primary cause for poor access to medicines in India. Sales of patented products account for much less than 1% of the Indian pharma market. Right. Thus, compulsory licensing of patented products cannot have any meaningful impact. How do you respond to this?
Well, access to medicine is not only an issue of pricing. There are infrastructure and other issues, but pricing is the real concern. And what government is concerned about is that in case of a health emergency, whether this provision is going to work or not going to work. And that's what government wants to test it out. As far as Indian Pharmaceutical Alliance or Indian industry is concerned, they are not looking at this as a business model or a business strategy. They are only complying with what government wants, that in case such a situation arises, are there players in Indian industry who would come forward and meet not only India's requirement, but many other developing countries' requirement.
All right, Mr. Shah, then let me come to the second point that they raised, that, you know, the laws that we currently have which deal with the issue of compulsory licenses are sufficiently clear and flexible, and they actually can be used in appropriate cases quite effectively. Why do you think that the current law and the current regulatory framework as it exists is not sufficient?
Well, this is precisely what is being tested, whether these laws are adequate or not. On paper, they look very adequate. But from the time this discussion has started, one company has put in an application for compulsory license. 4 months have passed. Let's see how long it takes to get a compulsory license and for that company to produce the drug and bring it to the shelves in the market.
Will this align us with the WTO, with the TRIPS agreement? For instance, you know, Peter Mandelson in his letter very clearly says that compulsory licenses should be invoked only in very exceptional measures. Even as far as the European Commission is concerned, the IPR enforcement report of 2009 states that compulsory licenses should remain as a last resort. Is India going TRIPS plus in that sense, or WTO plus in that sense?
Well, we have a precedent in the United States. When 4 patients died out of anthrax, US was willing to issue a compulsory license, and Indian companies were invited to supply. Now, whether in waiting for that situation, before that government wants to test it out, and it's not only India's emergency. India is a supplier to the world, and many developing countries are dependent on India. So whether they are able to get the requirement in case of health emergency or a public health problem, these provisions are being tested out, and I don't understand why any industry should have an objection to a provision which they are not objecting if it's being tested out.
All right, this issue of compulsory licensing is now also being linked to the foreign direct investment into India, whether it's greenfield or brownfield, so that in a sense also impacts the merger and acquisition rules as far as the pharma sector is concerned. Now, your concern, or the concern of the IPA, is that there will be an oligopolistic market that will be developed if we do see these large-scale acquisitions of Indian companies by multinational companies, and it will lead to a lack of access, and more importantly, it will lead to jacking up of prices. But the OPPI, or the MNC lobby, believes that these fears are unfounded and unsubstantiated.
This is not concern of IPA. This is the concern of the government and the Ministry of Health. This whole debate initiated at the instance of Ministry of Health. And there have been enough evidence, if one wants to see, that how in a situation where there are no alternative supplier, the prices of even off-patent drug have remained very high. And these instances and names of products, names of companies are all available with the government. So it is an initiative from the government that if a situation arises where there should be a requirement, and whether Indian companies will be, which are capable, would there be there to meet the government requirement.
Do you think it is fair, DG Shah, that the government actually now brings the pharmaceutical sector, removes it from the automatic route, and actually every transaction needs to go to the FIPB? This is something that a lot of countries do have. It's of course in the form of the Competition Commission in various other countries. But do you think this makes sense? It is rational for India to actually remove pharmaceutical from the automatic route and allow these transactions into India only once they get the clearance of the FIPB?
But what I've read in the media and which government is talking about is two sets of rules where a company is bringing a new technology and making investment, it will be automatic route. But where company wants to acquire an existing Indian companies, it will have to go through the FIPB route. So this distinction, there is nothing wrong. We have this distinction in number of industries, in insurance, banking, aviation. We have caps beyond which foreign companies are not allowed to invest. Such rules are there even in the Western countries where they do not allow acquisition by foreign companies. So if India considers pharmaceutical a sensitive industry for its obligation to even the developing world and its own 1 billion people, there is nothing wrong if government.
But are you in favor of an FDI ceiling? We understand from sources that there was a proposal of capping it at about 49%. Are you in favor of any sort of a ceiling, and also, you know, whether ownership should retain with the Indian promoters, or do you think that once the FIPB is clear of all of its apprehensions with regards to things like compulsory licenses, with regards to things like patents, which the CSIR may have funded or may have been involved with, that, you know, these deals should be given the go-ahead?
But there is no proposal to kept it at 49. What it said was that automatic route in brownfield would remain automatic up to 49, and if one wants to go beyond 49 to 100%, one will have to go through the FIPB route. So there is no question of any ceiling which is being proposed. And IPA certainly has not been involved in this debate. This is a debate going on between Ministry of Health and Ministry of Commerce and Industry.
Absolutely, you're absolutely right that this has been something that has been initiated by the government, and these are only suggestions or recommendations that are coming in from various quarters of industry. Do you think, as we know, the discussion paper, as is publicly available, DG Shah, is likely to go through and get cabinet's approval?
Looking at the papers and what has been discussed so far in Delhi, with this proposal of compulsory licensing and FDI capping or using a greenfield and brownfield route will go through.
We will come back to you, and hopefully with the OPPI as well, on this discussion. But for the moment, many thanks for joining us and taking us through what this really means for the Indian consumer and for Indian pharmaceutical as a business as well. Thanks very much for joining us on What's Hot.
Thank you.